In the previous sections, we saw that tightening the bolts produces compressive stress on the mating components even before any operational loads are applied. These stresses affect both the static and the dynamic behavior of the assembly. Applications such as seals and gaskets that are static in nature show how the pre-stress due to bolt preload creates contact pressure to achieve proper closure before operational loads are applied. For dynamic systems such as mounting vibrating equipment or tires in vehicles, not having enough bolt preload can result in unpleasant vibrations that can be both annoying and dangerous. This is because the initial stress developed in the assembly due to bolt preload changes the overall stiffness of the assembly. For example, when the applied bolt preload is insufficient, the overall stiffness of the bolted assembly reduces, and this in turn changes its natural frequencies. But what's natural frequency and how is it affected by pre-stress? Let's take a step back and see what the natural frequency of an assembly is. Consider a spring mass system with one end of the spring fixed and a mass attached to its other end. If the mass is displaced from its mean position and then let go, the system starts to oscillate with a certain constant frequency, which is nothing but the natural frequency of the system. The natural frequency for this spring mass system is given by the square root of the spring stiffness k divided by the mass m. Therefore, natural frequency of any system depends on both its stiffness and its mass. To understand the effect of pre-stress on natural frequency, let's look at the example of guitar tuning. When we tune a guitar, we effectively stretch or loosen the strings. By doing so, we alter the stress in them, which changes its stiffness. Therefore, it affects its natural frequency. A tensile pre-stress generally increases the natural frequency, while a compressive pre-stress reduces the natural frequency. Bolt preload plays a similar role on bolted joints. Applying more or less bolt preload changes the initial stress state of the assembly, and this may change its natural frequency. This can be realized by studying the governing equations of motion for such systems. Here are the equations of motion for any general dynamic system that is under influence of an external load. Its overall response is captured by three solution terms, namely displacements, velocities, and accelerations. These responses are affected by three properties of the system, which are the mass matrix, the damping matrix, and the stiffness matrix. Each of these matrices show how the respective properties are distributed throughout the system. In case of undamped systems, the damping matrix reduces to zero, and therefore we can eliminate that term. What we are left with are the equations of motion for an undamped system. In cases where the inertial effects are negligible, which is generally the case in bolted structures during the preloading stage, the mass term can be neglected, which leaves us with a simplified version of this equation. This equation represents the response of a static system, and this is the equation that we solve for in calculating stresses, pressures, and reaction forces in a preloaded bolted joint. As we mentioned earlier, the presence of stress changes the stiffness of a system. So, when we analyze a preloaded bolted joint, we solve for the stresses developed in the part in first load step, lock the bolt preload, and then apply external loads. When we do this, the change in stiffness due to preload in step 1 is calculated in the form of a stress stiffening matrix, and when we apply external loads in step 2, the modified system's response due to stress stiffening is considered. In fact, even when we study dynamic characteristics of such system, stress stiffening matrix is first calculated and added to the initial stiffness of the system. This modified stiffness is used in calculating the natural frequencies, and that's how the effect of pre-stress on dynamic characteristics is captured. Let's revisit the example of guitar tuning and calculate its natural frequencies before and after tuning. Before tuning, here are the first 10 natural frequencies of the system. Now, if we introduce some stress in the strings by stretching them during tuning, here are the same 10 frequencies calculated after introducing pre-stress. It's very clear that the strings are vibrating at a much larger frequency after tuning. The same concept extends to preload in bolts. Tightening the bolts increases preload and introduces stress in the system. As the stiffness of the system increases, it does not vibrate that easily. This can be realized by calculating the natural frequencies of a bolted structure before and after applying preload. But before we get that far, there's one more topic to discuss pertaining to solver settings that must be considered. It's whether to use large deformation. Large deformation is a type of formulation that is used in situations that involve, well, large deformation. Particularly, when the change in shape of the system is noticeable, then it's a good idea to turn this formulation on. Using large deformation in solving the governing equations of motions takes into account four types of nonlinearities, namely large strain, large rotation, stress stiffening, and spin softening. While all these are important factors, it's worth noting that in case of bolted joints, large strain and stress stiffening are prominent. So we will focus on them. The stress stiffening here is same as what we discussed earlier. So turning on large deformation considers both the change in shape and the stress stiffening. We have seen why stress stiffening is important. But is change in shape important too? Let's look at the example of a fishing pole to learn and see how change in shape matters. The fishing pole is a tall, slender structure, and it acts like a cantilever beam under the influence of fish weight. If the weight of the fish is W and the length of the fishing pole is L, then the deflection of the pole at the tip is given by this relation. When the length of the pole remains unchanged, we can see that this relationship reduces to a linear function between the tip deflection and the weight of the fish. But the length of the pole does not remain constant if there's even slightest deflection. At very small deflections, the change in length is negligible, and this relationship is valid. But as the deflection increases, the change in length is noticeable, and therefore this equation is no longer valid. This shows how the results deviate from linear behavior at large deformations and why it is important to consider them while analyzing bolted structures. Using large deformation makes the analysis nonlinear, which is typically more expensive. Also, in a multi-step analysis, when we use large deformation in the first load step, the following steps continue using it, which adds to the computation time. So, it may be beneficial to use small deformation in large models that do not deform so much. But how do we decide whether the deformation is large or small? There's no rule of thumb to answer this. It's subjective to the application. A few instances in case of bolted joints where it's recommended to use large deformation are: first, when the mating parts or the bolts have nonlinear material behavior. Secondly, when there are nonlinear contacts such as frictional contacts in the model. Third, when some of the parts undergo large deformations such as gaskets and seals. Or finally, when sliding of the components is of interest, such as in case of shear joints. If it's not clear whether large deformation is needed for an application, it is recommended to always use large deformation. In case of design iterations, one may run two cases, one with and one without large deformation, to check the difference in results and decide whether to use large deformation in all other simulations. In terms of governing equations, the large deformation captures changes in stiffness due to change in shape, material nonlinearities, contact nonlinearities, spin softening, and stress stiffening.